Hey everyone, Patrick from the Monterey Bay Aquarium here for a very special video collaboration with BBC's Earth Unplugged. This is Laz.
Hey guys.
And together, we're gonna look at the amazing ways that life is adapted to being on land and in the ocean in two videos at the same time. Now for this to work, we have to synchronize our video with the BBC's video. So here's what you do. You click the link below and open it up in a new browser window and get ready to hit play on both videos at the same time in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Oh wait, hold on. Sorry, I forgot my mask. Real quick, let me just grab that. Okay. You know, air is something that you don't think about until it's gone. And as a scuba diver, I'm really conscientious about how much air I have in my tank on my back and also the air pressure that I'm experiencing on my body. In water, pressure goes up very quickly. In fact, the deeper you go, the more the air you're breathing feels like you're drinking a liquid.
Amazingly, we share a dive response with these mammals. When our head goes in cold water, our heart rate slows dramatically, allowing us to conserve oxygen. To stay comfortable in 12 degree water, or 52 degrees for us Americans, we need to have a very thick wetsuit, need to have warm gloves and boots just to be able to be in this cold environment. Now, cold water can mean that a lot of animals can live longer than in warmer temperatures. Animals like these rockfishes, this black rockfish, this China rockfish next to me, some of their cousins have been aged over 200 years old. And that's all thanks to this chilly water that we're in. From creatures in the deep to life in the shallows, the ways that life has adapted to light in the ocean are fascinating. In the ocean, light bends and bounces, losing colors as it goes deeper, starting with the color red. We can illustrate that with what's called an Ishihara test. Could be a 5, maybe. Maybe 10, I'm not sure. 68. So, as you can see, I didn't do too well on that test. Whatever, Laz. But in the wild, a lot of animals are using color in a very different way than we do. For example, mantis shrimp that live in the shallows, they have more color receptors in their eyes than we do. And scientists think that that may allow mantis shrimp to have secret communication with other mantis shrimp without giving them away to predators. But where there's less light in the inky blackness of the deep sea, other visual strategies take over. Many animals in the ocean are counter-shaded. They're dark on their back and they're light on their belly. If you're above the fish looking down, you're looking at a black back that gets disguised in the darkness of that abyss. But if you're below the fish looking up, then you're looking at a bright belly that's camouflaged against the sun, allowing them to stay hidden from predators from above and below. And in water, that sound travels nearly 1,500 meters per second, 4.3 times faster than in air. Now that can be useful for dive guides that can clang on their tanks to have their clients follow them around. It's very effective. But since our ears aren't adapted to hearing the difference in arrival time between left and right, it's really hard to tell where sound is coming from. Now, of course, animals in the ocean have evolved to use sound in really incredible ways. You may have heard that dolphins echolocate to find a meal. They send out tiny pulses of sound, and they can see with their ears as the sound waves come back to them, just like bats do on land. And you also may have heard of humpback whales singing during the mating season. But maybe my favorite way that animals use sound in the ocean is schooling fishes, similar to the anchovies and sardines next to me. Schools of herring have been known to use their farts to find each other at night and stay in that schooling pattern. Yeah, that's right, you heard me correctly. Schooling fish like herring use gas to coordinate their movements in the dark. And I think that deserves a high five from Laz over here. Blue whales brings us on to size. One of the most spectacular things about the ocean and the life in it is quite literally the spectacle. The tree next to Laz here has to stand up its entire life to the force of gravity. It has to be rigid to resist that ever-present pull. But here in the ocean, animals don't have that same issue. They play by a different set of rules. The ocean is home to some of the fastest growing plants in the world. This giant kelp here can grow to be over 60 meters long, growing 30 centimeters every single day, and buoyed up by these small little bulbs of gas so it can reach the light and feed from the sun. The three-dimensionality of life in the ocean is really a defining difference from life on land. We really live in a 2D environment when we're there on the sky floor. But in the ocean, there's life from the bottom all the way up to the surface. So imagine if looking up as we walked around on land, we could see massive jelly birds going through the air, being chased by sky turtles. And I think we can all agree that we're very fortunate not to have to worry about 30 meter long invertebrate predators stinging us on our way to work. Entire communities of organisms live their whole lives perpetually in this midwater. Small little copepods will walk through the water like molasses thanks to small hair-like projections that increase their surface area. And meanwhile, in the darkness of the abyss, hanging out silently in the water column, are vampire squid lying in wait for sinking wastes. So there you have it, two incredible worlds.
Each showcasing remarkable adaptations to life in the air and in the water. In fact, scientists think that 95% of the deep sea is still unexplored. Scuba diving is one thing, but advances in submersible technology are opening up new frontiers of exploration every day.
It is amazing to think about what still might be out there waiting for us to discover it.
It really is. There's so much we still don't know about our world. And hey everyone, if you enjoyed this video, you can dive into way more about our blue planet on Earth Unplugged's channel. Go ahead and check them out.
You made a bit of a mess in there, didn't you?
Yeah, good thing they're cleaning up. Sorry about that.
And I think we should do out my side.
Oh, right, yeah. Your side. Yep.